Skeletal muscles come in a variety of shapes and sizes. One of the factors that differs among skeletal muscles is the way fibers within them are arranged. And by muscle fibers, we're always referring to the individual muscle cells themselves. So in a case here, we have two different possible arrangements, sort of the most basic of the varieties possible. On the left here, we have what are called fusiform fiber arrangement or fusiform muscle. These are also called parallel fiber arrangements because the muscle fibers shown here in the middle, these long thin cylinders, are running parallel to the direction of the muscle itself. In other words, the tendons are at the ends here, right? We would have a tendon here and a tendon here. The attachment points would be in general bone at the ends of those tendons. We can see we've got our lines of attachment here, which is basically just representing the connective tissues that are interspersed around the individual muscle fibers and bundles of those muscle fibers, and that come together to attach to and form the tendon itself at the ends of the muscle. Now, in this fusiform fiber, where the cells are all parallel, we get a fair amount of shortening possible because the fibers are shortening in the exact same direction that the force is being generated. So that's a plus in terms of fusiform arrangement. It's a long range of movement. Now, when we talk about the force generated by a specific muscle, that always comes down to the cross-sectional area of the fibers involved in generating that force. And so in a fusiform muscle, the cross-sectional area of the individual fibers, we could just draw a line here through the middle, and we would be cutting through all of the individual fibers of that muscle. So the anatomical cross-section actually matches what we call the physiological cross-section of this muscle, meaning all of those cells are contributing to the contractile strength of this muscle and their cross-sectional area, right? If we were to turn this on its side and look at the cut edge, right? The cross-sectional area of these individual fibers is determining the force possible, right? The maximum force possible when it's fully stimulated. If we go over to the right side here, we now have an arrangement where the tendon is actually offset, right? On one side of the muscle, it's sort of over here. On the other side, it's kind of over here. And there's a variety of arrangements where we had this sort of like offset tendon. We're just showing you one here. But the muscle fibers themselves are in what's called a pennate formation or a pennate arrangement. And pennate refers to feather-like. If you think of a feather, right, there's usually a central shaft and then the components of that form the feather itself sort of come off at an angle, right? And so we've got something like that. We've got half of that right here. So you've got unipennate in this case. And the upside of pennate muscles is that the cross-sectional area, the anatomical cross-sectional area would be right across the middle like this again. But you can see that it's not cutting through all the individual cells, right? The physiological cross-sectional area would be this, right? This vertical line would cut through all of the fibers contributing to this muscle's tension. And you can see that's actually a significantly greater number of muscle fibers and therefore a greater cross-sectional area or physiological cross-sectional area. So we would have a more force, potentially more force generated by this pennate fiber arrangement. One of the negatives of pennate fiber arrangement is that because the muscle fibers are all pulling at an angle against their tendons, we get a limited range of motion, right? These don't shorten as dramatically. An interesting point to make is that a lot of very large muscles are often in pennate fiber arrangement. And that hints at the idea that this generation of greater force is a plus for those larger muscles moving larger loads, a bigger portion of our body mass.